Welcome everyone to this webinar hosted by Toradex with the title Add USB-C to your next carrier board design. My name is Peter Lischer. I'm a senior hardware developer at Toradex. Yesterday I made my 15th year working for Toradex. If you have ever used a Toradex computer module in the past, the chances are actually pretty high that I was involved in the hardware design of this module. Before we dive into the webinar, let me cover a few organizational points. Please use the chat window of the webinar tool if you have any technical issues and you wish to let us know. At the end, we will have an interactive question and answer session, so you can type your questions in the chat window at any time, and we will pick them up at the end of the presentation. The webinar will be recorded and made available for on-demand viewing afterwards. Let me start with a brief overview of Toradex and what we do. Toradex is focusing on making embedded computing easy to use, so you can get simple access to the latest technology for your product development. We are doing that by providing highly reliable ARM system on modules, which includes software and support. We are striving to offer the lowest cost of ownership to you, and that doesn't just mean the module price, it also considers aspects like development effort, time to market, and long-term maintenance. Here on the map, you can see that we have offices all around the world with local support and warehouses. Myself, I'm located in the headquarters here in Lucerne, Switzerland. This is a short overview of our main products, our computer modules. We have the Colibri, the Palis, and our latest, the Verdin family. They're all within it themselves pin compatible. I would like to explain you also the focus of our applications as we are optimizing our products and offerings for them. We are mainly focusing on industrial automation, healthcare, transportation, test and measurement, and smart cities. Our typical customers have products in which the volumes are ranging from a few hundred to a few 10,000 per year. Toradex itself has more than 1,000 active customers. With that little marketing session, I would like to start with the actual topic for today, with USB-C. I found this table here on wikipedia.org, which gives you a really good overview what USB-C is and where it belongs into the family of USB. So basically what we have here are the different generations of USB, so the different standards, and when which connector was introduced. USB-C is basically just another connector, but as you can see, it's going to replace all of the other existing connectors in the standard 3.2 and upwards. So all other interfaces are going to be disappearing. We used to have the type A connector, which was on the host side. And then we had the type B connector, which was on the client side. And the name C comes from, it's the next logical letter after A and B, because it is the C, which is on host and client side. You're probably familiar with the old connectors, like the type A connector here, until the version 2.0, in which we only had low, full, and high speed, we just needed four pins in USB. So we had VBUS, we had D minus, and D plus, and ground. That's all we needed. When they introduced super speed in the version 3.0, they needed additional five pins. The additional five pins are for the super speed signals. Super speed are an RX and TX pair. They are like PC Express, and they also needed an extra ground for it. As you can see on the Type A connector, they were able to neatly put them here on the back, this extra 5 pins here. You see them here on the back. On the Type B, they already had to add here this bump here to make it available and backward compatible. When it came to the micro connector, it got a little bit, special, let's say. So they added this extra pins here on the side, which confused a lot of people. A lot of people had problems, especially when they had a 3.0 port and they wanted to connect the smaller one, just the 2.0 port, so which side it goes in. So it was really not a very user-friendly solution. That was the reason why they added USB-C to the game. It's a new connector, which is for the first time we can have it rotation symmetrical, so we can plug it in both ways. And instead of the 9 pins the previous connector had, we have now 24 pins. But don't get confused with all these pins, because it's actually not that complicated. So we still have ground VBUS. We have 4 pins of each of them. These are rotation symmetrical, that you can plug it both ways. And we have the D plus and D minus, so the 2.0 signals here in the middle, and they're actually shadowed here in a rotation symmetrical way on both sides. So the receptacle provides the signals on both sides here, the D plus, D minus, so that's really the same signal, while the plug only connects it on the A side. The B side of the D plus, D minus is left open. So the connector or the plug and the cable, they don't have these signals here. On the previous USB, we had only one lane of super speed signals. One lane means one TX, one RX pair. While on the USB-C, we have now 2 lanes. They are here, so rotation symmetrical here, the yellow ones here on the left and here on the right side. The only actual new signals that we have are the 2 configuration channel signals here, CC1, CC2, and this SBU signals here, sideband usage signals, basically reserved for future use pins they are. I will talk about these signals a bit later. Let's see for what we can actually use the USB-C connectors, because we can use it in different ways. We can still use USB-C as a regular 2.0 low full high speed interface. In this case, we just use ground VBUS, and in the middle here, these D plus D minus signals. We actually need the CC signals here, but I will talk about them later in my presentation, how that works. If we are going super speed, we need the extra super speed signals. We either use one or both lanes for it. Theoretically, we don't need the 2.0 full high speed signals for a super speed interface, but for compatibility purpose, we also need to provide them on a receptacle here in the middle. We can use USB-C for powering only, so we can use it as a power plug basically, or power interface, and in this case we just need ground VBUS and we need the CC pins for configuration of power. More to that later in the presentation. We can use USB-C also in alternate functions, so we can use it for example as a display port interface. In this case, DisplayPort has up to 4 data lines, and we simply reuse the super speed signals here, the yellow ones, as DisplayPort signals. DisplayPort also has an auxiliary channel interface, so basically that's a configuration channel for configuring the displays. This interface is then set to the SPU signals here. In case we are using DisplayPort, we can still use the 2.0 USB as an additional USB connection in between. We can also use the USB-C for things like audio interfaces. So you may have seen already this kind of dongles here that you can connect your cell phone to a headphone. And in this case, we are using the sideband signals here as microphone and ground, and the two data signals are left and right signals here. With that, I would like to make a first short break and launch a little poll with you. So I would like to know from you whether you have already been using USB-C in the past of your design. So please select whether you have used it in the past. So possible answers are no, but I'm planning to use it for my next design. Yes, for data only. Yes, for powering my device. Or yes, for data and power. I mean power, with power I mean really power delivering, so power your device. Okay, I will leave the poll open for a little bit more. Please fill in. Okay, I'm going to close it and share with you the answers. Okay, most of you are actually haven't used the USB-C in the past, but you're planning to do that. So yeah, that's probably why we are here in this webinar. So thank you. Okay, with that, let's go and learn some new stuff. So the first thing when it comes to USB-C, we have to get familiar with some terms that are very often used in the documents and documentation. And these are terms which maybe are new to you because they were not so dominantly used in the previous generations. The first two things is downstream facing port and upstream facing port. Basically, when we're talking about downstream facing port, we mean a host port which starts the enumeration of the bus and it provides power to the bus. While an upstream facing port is a device which takes power from the bus and gets enumerated. So typically, a USB thumb drive, for example, is an upstream facing port, while a PC or a laptop is a downstream facing port. In previous USB generations, we were using the term OTG on the go for devices that can change their roles. They can be client or host. The term OTG is completely gone in USB-C. It's replaced by the terms dual role device and dual role power. So it's actually two terms. One describes the data direction and the other one describes the power direction. The reason why they split these two terms is that when you have, for example, here a docking station, a USB-C docking station, then the data direction is usually from the laptop to the docking station, so it goes down, while the power goes the other way. So the docking station powers your laptop. So these two roles can be independent of each other. Okay, we have now been talking about the pinout here of USB-C. Let's now focus the next couple of minutes to this configuration channel pins, as they are pretty important for USB-C. What is the purpose of these configuration channel pins? So they have three major purposes. The first one is the orientation of the cable. So in USB-C, we need to know which way around the cable is plugged into the receptacle. So whether we have plugged it normally or flipped. This is done by having on the downstream facing port two pull-up resistors on these two signals and by the upstream facing port two pull-downs. So the host has two pull-ups, the client or the device has two pull-downs. The cable itself, a passive cable, only connects the A side of the connector on each of these connector pins. By measuring now the voltages on both sides here, the cable can detect whether it's connected regularly, unflipped, or it is connected flipped. So that's the first important role or task of the configuration channel. The next one is role detection. In the previous USB generations, we had type A and type B connectors, so it was clear which side is which. So an A was a host side, a B was a client side. You were not able to connect two hosts together because officially A to A cables were not existing, even though they actually exist, but they're illegal according to the USB standard. So the roles were clear. With USB-C, you only have USB-C on both sides. So the system need to know whether you actually connected a downstream facing port with an upstream facing port or with dual role ports. You have to connect the correct way around. And that is also done with that pull-up, pull-down situation. So because both sides are measuring the voltages here, they know if the other side has the correct pull-down or the correct pull-up resistor plugged in. So you can detect whether the correct roles are plugged in. And then the third really important part is power detection. So there is a simple way to detect power, and it is by changing here this pull-up resistor here from 5622 to 10k value. So depending on the values here, the pull-up resistor have here on the downstream facing port, the upstream facing port knows by measuring the voltage here, what is the capability, how much current the downstream facing port can deliver. More to that a bit later. But with the configuration channel pins, we can do even more. We can actually use it as a bus. It's a bus like a one-wire bus, more or less. So it allows to do real communication between the downstream facing port, the upstream facing port, and in some cases, even with the cable. Because there are cables available which have an IC in it, which have a marker chip in it. And this IC here tells the system what the cable is capable of. Because in some power configurations, even the cable needs to agree on, needs to be giving the okay that it can transport this amount of current or this amount of voltage. Such a cable needs to have power, and the power is delivered by the second CC pin. So the CC pin that is not used as a bus is used for providing power to the system here. It's always 5 volt, this power, this VCON power. It's independent of VBUS. So VBUS can have a different voltage, while VCON has always 5 volt and is maximum 1 watt. And it's used for cables, with marker chip. It can also be used for signal repeaters, adapters, or bridge chips with maximum 1 watt. How does it actually work in detail? So let's assume we have a source and a sink here. As long as they're not connected, the source here has the pull-ups resistor enabled with the correct value. It measures the voltage here on the pull-up resistor to check whether anything is connected. As long as nothing is connected, here we have 5 volt on both of them. There is one important thing here, that VBUS needs to be turned off. As long as nothing is connected, there is no VBUS on the USB-C. So that's a big difference between a type A receptacle and a type C receptacle. On the type A, VBUS was always available. So even if you have nothing connected to a type A receptacle, the 5 volts are still there. While on USB-C, it needs to be turned off. The same goes with the sink side also has the pull downs and measures also the voltage here. So if it's a self-powered device, which actually has power, it can detect here whether anything is connected. And it knows nothing is connected, doesn't have to react. If you connect now these two things together, so you connect VBUS, ground, and one side of the CC, the A side of the connector side. In this case, this voltage here drops down because you have the pull down here. this voltage here drops down, so the IC detects, okay, it was not flipped, plugged in, and a sink is flipped in. In this case, it switches now the other side of this connector to VCON to provide any power to active cables, and it turns on the VBUS source for the bus power. With that bus power, the sink gets powered, and it detects here that the voltage has risen up, so it knows it has been connected, so it can initiate the ask for getting enumerated, like on the previous USB generations. Of course, the same also works if you have a dual role device here on the left. A dual role device just has the option to either enable pull up or pull downs, but the rest is the same, and it can enable a source or sink to the bus power, but it works in this combination. Of course, a dual role device can also be on the right side and act as a sink. So if it's connected to a source, it just enables the pull down resistors here. You can also connect two dual role devices together. One is then acting as a source while the other one as a sink. So one is enabling the pull up resistors and provides VCON, while the other one is having the pull downs enabled, and depending on the configuration you want to have, one is then sinking and the other one is sourcing power. Well, somebody could also connect just two sinks together, which is obviously not working, but the good thing is, since we have these pull downs here, we have no voltage on the VBUS that nobody is delivering here. Both sides don't see any increase of the voltage here of the signal here. So both sides are not seeing each other. So nothing happens, nothing blows up. So you can connect two things together, but it is not blowing up. That's the important thing. You can even connect two sources together accidentally and nothing happens, nothing blows up, because of course, the two pull-ups here don't see each other, so the voltage doesn't go down. And in this case, both sides here are not allowed to turn on the VBUS source here. So that is the main reason why VBUS is turned off. As long as the other side, you don't see as a source, you don't see the sink size. So you need to have the VBUS turned off, because then you don't have any collisions on the VBUS. So you don't end up powering from both sides and getting unpredictable situations. So nothing blows up again. You may have seen already that we still use a lot of these kind of cables where you have a type A on one side and the type C on the other side. These cables exist, they're official. The only thing they need to have inside the cable, they need to have this 56K pull-up resistor to tell a USB-C system that they are available. So it is plugged in so that this side here knows the other side is available, and to the 56K to indicate that it is an old system. Also, type C to type A adapters exist. In this case, this pull-down resistor needs to be in the adapter, and it is absolutely essential to have this pull-down resistor, because as we have learned, as long as the source doesn't see this pull-down resistor, doesn't see anything plugged in, it's not allowed to turn on the VBUS. And since on a type A connector VBUS is always enabled, this pull-down resistor needs to be present to permanently turn on VBUS. Okay, with that, I would like to do another short break and come to another little poll. This time it's a little quiz I would like to do with you. So what do you think is the voltage and current USB-C can deliver in the year 2022? So is it maximum 5 volt 0.5 amps? Is it maximum 5 volt 0.3 amps? Is it maximum 20 volt 5 amps it can deliver, or is it 48 volt 5 amps that it can deliver? So these are the maximum values. Okay, I will keep the quiz running for a few more seconds. Okay, thank you for voting. I'm going to close it and share with you the answers. It's interesting answers, I would say this way. And I'm not going to reveal the correct answer right now, as we will see it in a few moments, what the correct answer is. Okay, so we have been talking about the configuration channel pins. Now we want to talk about power delivery, how we configure the correct current and voltage that we want to have on USB-C. For that, we have different levels in this power delivery. The first three levels are backward compatible to the old system. So these first three levels are the only ones that we can have on a type A to type C adapter cable, because they are existing from the old previous generation. So first, or in this case, we have always a 56 kilo ohm resistor, either on the downstream facing port or in this adapter cable here. And we are either in this default USB configuration, so it's USB 2.0 or 3.x. In this case, we can draw 5 volt, 0.5 or 0.9 amps maximum, but we are only allowed to draw the maximum current here if we enumerate and ask for that current. So we need to be enumerated in USB. Otherwise, we are only allowed to draw 100 or 150 milliamps. That's it. A couple of years ago, the first cell phones were coming to the market, which used the micro USB connector for charging. And back then, of course, 2.5 watts was not enough for charging a cell phone. So that's why they introduced the USB BC 1.2 standard. BC stands for battery charging. The thing is that, as we have seen, we need to enumerate to get even 0.5 amps. And in a wall charger here, we do not really want to put in a whole microprocessor that you are allowed or you can do enumeration. So a different solution had to be established. And this was by just simply shorting the D plus D minus lines inside the 2.0 signals. We short them here inside the charger, and this is detected by the device. And in this case, it knows it's a wall charger and it can draw 1.5 amps, 5 volt maximum. Higher currents are possible, but I don't want to go here into details because, it's getting quite big this topic. And also you might have heard that you can have higher voltages than 5 volt, like in quick charge from Qualcomm and other similar products, but these are not standard USB protocols, so they're not part of the USB. With USB-C, two additional simple power delivery protocols are added. And the easy ones are just changing the resistor to 22 or 10K. So with 22, you announce that you can do 5 volt 0.5 amps. When with 10K, you announce 5 volt 3 amps. Keep in mind, this is only possible if you have USB-C on both ends, because you need this configuration channel. It's not possible with the old type A connectors. So you can have up to 15 watts in this way. If you start using the configuration channel as a bus, where you communicate and negotiate voltage and current, you can have between 5 to 20 volt, any voltage here between, and up to 5 amps, so 100 watt. So up to a bit more than a year, this was the correct answer to my previous quiz. So 20 volt, 5 amps. But USB actually extended its power delivery protocol about a year ago, Now 48 volt, 5 volts are possible. So it's now possible to have up to 240 watts on a USB-C connector. It's quite crazy when you think about it. So that's the correct answer to the previous quiz. When it comes to power, you usually until 15 watts, you can do it with simple resistors. You don't need this protocol thing where you have to negotiate or anything. That's pretty simple. If you want to go higher, you usually first increase the voltage before you go above 3 amps. There is a reason for that, because regular cables, they're capable of up to 3 amps. Well, if you want to go higher than 3 amps, the cable needs to allow more than 3 amps. So it needs to have a marker in it, which says, yes, it can do more than 3 amps. Unfortunately, it's very often, it's a bit ugly to figure out which cable is capable of doing that. Some cables like that one here, they have a text here on it, which says 100 watt here. So this one is actually one that has a marker in it, but there is no universal kind of way to tell that, unfortunately. It's also that if you want to go higher than 20 volt, you need a marker. So all the extended power range, they also need to have a marker. So this cable actually here is not capable of doing more than 20 volt. So you would need to another cable, which can do more than 20 volt. How does an implementation look like in this case here? So this is a very simple schematic taken from our design guide. So it's a schematic that we use on the Verdin development board. It's a dual role port, which can actually deliver power to the system. For that, we use this little IC here. It's from TI. It's called TUSB321. It's a neat little IC here that has this block diagram in it here. You can strap it to be either downstream facing, upstream facing, or dual role. So it can have the pull-ups or pull-downs enabled. And as you can see here, it can have different pull-up resistor because it can announce default current, medium, or high current to it. So it can do the whole detection here just on a resistor level. So it doesn't do any bus thingy here. So it just uses the resistor way. And it outputs here the ID signal. So it goes back to the OTG level in which the ID pin is used to tell to the system whether it's currently in a host or client situation. We can use that signal here to go into the Verdin module. The Verdin module uses that signal to know whether it should turn on the VBUS. And the VBUS is then enabled here by that little IC here. That's a simple voltage switcher here, which has a current limiter that we can set here to the same level as we announce here on that IC here. So it's a very simple schematic for that. This is another example of power delivery. This time it's a sink. It is used on our Dahlia board. So we implemented that on our Dahlia board. And this one actually can do the bus thing. So it can ask for more than 5 volt. It uses this ST microchip, chip here. It has an EEPROM in it, which you can select 3 different profiles you want to have. So these are the profiles you would like to have. And then it negotiates together with the source. For example, in this here, we have a source that can do 5 volt 3 amps, 9 volt 3 amps, 15 volt 2 amps. And then it negotiates according to the profiles we would like to have for a match and the best match we get. So we switch then to the best match. If we get a match, we have here the output that turns on. It turns on this power switch here and our system can boot or can start. That runs completely autonomous here. We have an additional IC here, which is this guy here, which is optional. And this one is a USB-BC IC. So it uses the 2.0 signals here to detect whether we are having any wall charger plugged in. And in this case, if we see a volt charger, we also allow the system to turn on. That's the whole thing. It looks a bit more complicated than it actually is. With that, I would like to have my last poll with you. So it's another little quiz. I may want to trick you into. So my question here is, what do you think? What are the minimum components you need for implementing a self-powered high-speed USB-C upstream facing port? So basically, a mouse, a thumb drive. So what do you need? Is it just two pull-down resistors you need? Do you need one of these TUSB 3-to-1 or something like that? Or do you need a USB PD controller IC like this ST Microelectronics one? Or do you need even a multiplexer together with the TUSB-C? Or you need everything like a PD, a multiplexer, or a microcontroller? Okay. I will keep running it for a few more seconds. Okay, I'm going to close it and reveal the results with you. That's very interesting. And this time I was actually not able to trick you into the wrong answer. So most of you gave the correct answer. And I will show it in a few slides, the actual answer. Okay, good. So we have been talking now about the configuration channel, the power part. Let's now go and talk about the actual data signals, how we are using them and what we have to do with them. I already mentioned it before, you can use USB-C with just low full high speed 2.0. In this case, you just use VBUS ground and this D plus D minus signals here in the middle. And you can provide them really to both sides here at the same times. So you don't need a multiplexer, an analog switch or anything because the signals here are in the middle. So the stops are pretty short to do that. So it's simply just provided on both sides. When it comes to USB 3.0 super speed, you definitely need the multiplexer. You need to detect which way around the cable is plugged in and then provide the signal if only on the side, on one side, on the correct one. If you do a one lane interface, obviously. Because the reason for that is, imagine that you have a long cable, let's say a meter, 2 meter or whatever, and it's a full featured cable. Full feature means it's a cable which has all four differential pair super speed signals connected, because you can have dual lane super speed. In this case, if you would provide your super speed signals simultaneously on both sides, you would just connect it on both like you do on D plus D minus, then you would have a meter, 2 meter long stops. And this is not going to work with a 5, 10, or even 20 gigabit interface signal. So you need a multiplexer. Let's see that in actual schematic. And here is the very simplest USB-C implementation you can have. And it's the answer to my previous quiz, which I was not able to trick you in. So this is an example when you want to do just an upstream facing port, like a mouse, a thumb drive or whatever, that is only using the 2.0 high speed interfaces. You simply connect the signals to both sides, the A and the B side of the cable, the VBUS, ground, and the only thing you need compared to a previous type B connector is just these two pull-down resistors here, 5.1K pull-down resistor. That's all you need. That's a fully compliant USB-C interface. So it's very simple to replace a type B micro type B connector in this case. If you want to do dual role or a replacement for an OTG port, it gets a little bit more complex, but we have already seen exactly that schematics a few minutes before when I was talking about power delivery. So the simple way is just using one of these ICs like the TUSB 3-to-1, which by the way, they're other similar ICs available from other manufacturers, and even TI has different ones which are available. And the thing is, this just does then the configuration here, dual role configuration, whether you're host client, you get the ID signal into the module, and then the module can, depending on that situation, can turn on with the enable pin here to power, and you're good to go. By the way, in all these two examples I showed you, in which we are only using 2.0, it's actually recommended to use a receptacle here which doesn't have the super speed pins populated here. So try to use one of these non-populated connectors. It's not because of price mainly, because they're probably not that much cheaper. It's mainly because of layout purpose, because the USB-C connector is quite small. It has 24 pins, and if you have all pins available, then it's quite tricky to route them. But connectors without, or receptacles without these pins, they're getting a slightly easier to route on your system. If you want to add super speed to the whole thing, then you need this multiplexer. You need a multiplexer. But again, you can simply use something like this TUSB 321, because it also has a direction output, and you can use it to select whether the A or B side of the cable is connected. There is a little trick here with it on that schematics. We swapped intentionally the CC1 and CC2 pins. With that, we can simply invert the direction pin here, because it was easier to lay out the multiplexer by having the B and C port here, or outputs here of that multiplexer, swapped. It was just an optimizing of the layout why we did that. What's a neat little trick you can do? And then the last example I want to give you here, I only have it as a block diagram since it's a bit more complex. It is how a full notebook system can look like. In this case, we can sync power, so we can charge our laptop with here 5 amps, 20 volt up to, or we can sync a device up to 5 volt, 3 amps. All is negotiated here by this PDIC here, and it has alternate function display port. In this case, we have the super speed signals coming here from the south bridge here, and we have the graphic signals here, the display port signals coming from the graphic card or graphic part of the CPU. They all go into that matrix switcher here, which then, depending what this guy here negotiated, can switch between super speed signals or display port, and it can also do the swapping of the flipped and non-flipped side. Important to know is that DisplayPort can do up to 4 lanes, but it can also run with 1 or 2 lanes. So if you just run it with 2 lanes, it is actually possible to use super speed in combination with 2-lane DisplayPort. But if you want to use higher resolutions, 4-lane DisplayPort, you're limited then to use 2.0 USB only. Then I want to give you here, as one of my last things I want to do with you, is a little example how you shouldn't do USB-C. This is the schematic of the power input port of the Raspberry Pi. It was the first revision of Raspberry Pi that came out, and it was the first one that was using USB-C as a power source. When it came out, it soon afterwards, people were detecting that they made a mistake, and it doesn't work in all situations. So what did they do? So they did connect the CC1 and CC2 pins together and used just one pull-down resistor here instead of two independent ones. Why did they do it? Well, as we have seen, by measuring here this voltage here, we can detect what type of downstream facing port, what type of source we have, whether it's what current capability it is. And by connecting both of them together, they were using only one ADC channel. So that was the advantage. Everything works fine as long we are just using a passive cable, which only has the connection on one side. So it doesn't matter whether these two guys are connected together. But unfortunately, if you connect an active cable, which has here this pull down, 1 kilo pull downs here on the power side here, then you get into problems because you now have the 1K in parallel to the 5.1K. So you accidentally see twice 1K-ish on this CC port here as a host here side. And unfortunately, seeing twice 1K means that it is an audio adapter port here. And a good power supply then just simply turns off power output because such an adapter doesn't need any power. So the Raspberry Pi was working fine as long as you were not using a good cable, an active cable, and a good power supply. Okay, with that, the last thing I want to give you is some useful links. Because, of course, we have only been able to scratch the surface within that 45 minutes I was talking to you so far. So you can read way more on the USB specifications. All the USB specifications are publicly available, so you don't need any registration, any fees to pay. You can download all the USB specifications on the USB.org. But I already warn you, quite a lot of pages there are. Then there are also three really good Wikipedia articles which explain a lot. The USB-C article, the USB 3.0 article, and the regular USB article are really good ones. Microchip has a nice little USB-C power delivery guide, which I also recommend. And if you want to start digging in how USB 2.0 on its single level works, it has nothing to do with really with USB-C, but it's still a document I highly recommend. It's USB in a nutshell, and this one really tells you the basic how enumeration works and all this kind of thing on a protocol level, but also on a hardware level. And then, of course, I also recommend our design guides, which are now updated to have a section which includes USB-C. Good. With that, I finished my presentation here, and I would like to go into the question and answer session. So there are already quite a few questions coming in. Please, you can still type them in if you have more questions, and I'm trying now to answer them. So the first one I got was, is it possible to emulate an old ID pin functionality with a USB-C connector? Yes, it is. And we have actually seen it a couple of times in my presentation. It's this now probably famous T-USB 321 or any of these similar ones that do actually exactly that one. So they show they emulate an old ID pin and therefore are compatible with our modules. When you're connecting two dual role devices together, which part acts as a source and which one as a sink? This is actually a good question. So if you connect two of them, so how does it work? So the thing is that a dual role device usually has a kind of a preferred role. It's called tri downstream facing or tri upstream facing port. So you can set usually what you prefer. Like a cell phone is usually tri upstream facing port, while a laptop is usually tri downstream facing port. That means usually when you connect a laptop and the cell phone together, the roles are clear. The cell phone gets as a client and the PC gets as a host. If you connect two systems together that have the same tri, then it's basically just in the beginning, it's just lock which one acts as what. But you may have seen already on your cell phone a drop down on Android in which you can change the roles. You can actually change even the roles on the fly. That's also possible. Okay, good. I think I have answered that one. Let me read it again. If I'm connecting two bidirectional USB-C sockets, which one has both signal rows connected as a receptacle. I don't know whether I fully understand the question. Do you mean the 2.0 signals in the middle? So the socket, the receptacle always have both signals provided, while the cable only connects one side. So that one is clear. Okay, and next question. Is it allowed to mix device host, power source, consumer functionality freely? Earlier, they were connected together, host source, device, consumer. Yes, that is really possible. As I explained here, for example, on a docking station, the data direction can be independent of the power direction. So that is really possible. Then I have another question here. You showed that when I'm using a four-lane display port as an alternate function, you can only have 2.0, not 3.0. But my USB-C docking station can drive two 4K screens and still provide 3.0 signals. How does it work? Well, the thing is, I was not talking about Thunderbolt so far, because most of the docking stations nowadays, they're not using anymore the DisplayPort as an alternate function. They use Thunderbolt as an alternate function. So in this case, the whole system switches from super speed to Thunderbolt. Thunderbolt is also a PCI Express-like interface. And with Thunderbolt, the super speed signals, as well as the DisplayPort signals, they get tunneled. So they get a protocol tunnel. So you don't have any more the physical display port signals on it. So that's how you do it. So you can do Thunderbolt, and Thunderbolt can run in the current specification up to 40 gigabit per second. So you can tunnel easily multiple four screen display port interfaces and super speed at the same time. So that is possible. Okay, then we have more questions. DRP to DRP, how is the decision made? Which one should be provide power? Yeah, that one I have already answered before. It's either by tri-sync, tri-source, or when you go into your cell phone, go to the drop-down, and you can actually even change it on the fly. So the devices can change their role on the fly. It is actually possible on the fly to change the roles. Next one. When the ID signal of the CC pin says the device is a peripheral role, does the USB voltage load switch then still need to be closed or only in the host role? No. If you are a client in this case, because that TUSB 3-2-1 solution, which has this ID, in this case, the roles are set, so we cannot really change it afterwards. So that means as long as we are in a client mode, we don't need to, or we are not allowed to provide power, so we only sync power or use it for detection if we are self-powered. Next question. How do I check that the design is USB compliant? Impedances, routing, negotiation power, data direction, which external partner, all in-house, what is a good start here? That's a very good question here. Unfortunately, I'm not able to give you a clear answer here or a clear recommendation. I mean, we can do in-house at Toradex, we can do the signal, compliance test for the signal here. That's what we can do, but unfortunately we cannot do a USB-C compliance test, like the power delivery, everything. For that, we also need external partners, unfortunately. Next question. When I'm using a 60-watt laptop USB-C charger for charging my phone. It does not charge as fast as with the original 45 watt charger. Why? So yes, this can be really frustrating with USB-C. So you think that you got your fancy 60 watt charger that should be more than enough than to charge your cell phone, but your cell phone still doesn't charge as fast as with the original charger. The reason for that is that we, first of all, we have this different voltage level. So not all charger can do all voltage levels. So if the negotiation takes part, sometimes, for example, the cell phone asks for 12 volt, but the charger doesn't have the 12 volt option. Maybe it only supports 9 volt and 15 volts. So it lacks the 12 volt. So it goes down to 9 volt in this case. That's one option. So you can, very often on the chargers, you have this little text here on the back in which it says what are all this different capability it can do. That's one thing. Then the other thing is that modern cell phones, they changed, or there's a new protocol appearing for cell phones. It's called PPS. By the way, this charger can do it. So PPS is a dynamic voltage change. So during your charging, the cell phone asks for different voltages depending on the charging level. So the advantage is then that the cell phone gets less warm during charging. But unfortunately, not all chargers already support that. So that could be a reason. Then the next question, why does my laptop docking station only work with the original USB-C cable? Well, the thing is, as I already mentioned before, it's sometimes pretty hard to figure out what the cables are capable of, because some cables can do high power, like this 100 watt cable here, but this 100 watt cable here doesn't have the super speed signals in it because it's only a charging cable here. They want to make it thinner, because if it would have 5 amps plus the super speed signals here, it would be too thick. So very often it's just to figuring out which cable has the capability that you need for your system. So that's a bit the pain with USB-C, to figure out what your cable is actually capable of. Then we have a next question. Do you have any experience with USB PD and galvanic isolation for higher powers? Unfortunately, I don't have any experience here. I mean, if you want to do galvanic isolation, the problem is, if you want to also do super speed, then you also have to isolate this ones here. So it could get quite tricky, but I don't have any experience. I know that, especially for Thunderbolt, there are now optical cable available. If you want to go more than 3 meters with Thunderbolt, because 3 meters is the official maximum length you can have with Thunderbolt on USB-C. But if you want to go higher, then we have optical cables, but they use just optical for the data. They still have the power, which is not galvanic isolated. So unfortunately, I cannot answer fully this question. At what point do you think it would be a crucial decision to change our design and start using USB-C? Well, definitely one thing would be if we go to USB 3.2 Gen, which means Gen 3 it is. It's called now Gen 3 times 2, which is the dual line variant. So if you want to do the dual line USB super speed, then you definitely need it. So if you want to go 20 gigabits per second, then it's a must. Other than that, it's probably more from the marketing side also, because I know myself, if I buy a new device, I now look that I get a USB-C device. I don't want to have any micro or type A stuff anymore. So it's probably more marketing. There is no clear indication that type A or or micro is completely to disappear as long as you just follow the old standards. So it's probably more a marketing decision. Okay, then the next question. Dahlia DRP USB-C port is not charging an iPad connected to it. Why? So the reason is probably, unfortunately, I don't know the iPad exactly what its requirement is, but I know what the Dahlia has. So our DRP port, the dual row port we have, we announce maximum 5 volt point or 0.5, 0.9 amps. So the standard capabilities. And very likely that's not enough for the iPad. So our DRP can only provide up to 2.5 or 4.5 watts. Theoretically, if you would like to try it out on the Dahlia, we have this TUSB 3-2-1 and there is strapping. So you could actually strap it to announce up to 3 amps. But that means you also need to change the resistor that is in the IC that does the power switching to have the current limit set to 3 amps. And of course, the whole power budget is then a bit outside, but for a test, it would be okay if you just try it out to modify it to try whether that works. Next question, do you know a replacement for the TUSB 3-2-1 in combination with the HD3SS3203 multiplexer? I know what you mean, because right now in the current situation, it's almost impossible to get hands on the TUSB 3-2-1 from TI, because that one is really sold out, unfortunately. The good thing is there are pin compatible replacements of that USB 3-2-1. If I remember correct, the names are 320 and something. If you write to the support channel, I can actually provide you the part numbers that are pin compatible. They are, depending a little bit what you want to do there, because they're having some different features. So it depends a little bit, but please write us an email to the support channel and we are trying to help you to figure out a replacement, because we are currently also facing the same issue with that TUSB 3-2-1. That it is getting obsolete. The next question, I saw in design in some designs I saw 200 nano bypass capacitor on the TX super speed lines. Are they required? Have they any special function? Yes, they are really important. So the thing is, super speed is like a PCI Express interface, and in the whole chain from the source to the sink, there need to be 100 nanofarad series capacitor. It is for DC decoupling, and that one is really essential. The capacitor is always at the TX side, and it should be as close as possible to the source. We have the whole topic in our design guide, so please open up our design guide, and in that design guide we show where you need to put them and where not, because on our module we already have the 100 nanometer nanofarad capacitors on the TX lines inside the module, because they need to be as close as possible to the source. But if you do a device down or a multiplexer, then you need extra capacitors. So please follow our design guide there. I tried in this guide to explain where the capacitor need to go. Okay, next question. Are there applications and cables where there are all four super speed pairs are used to get higher speeds, or always just use one RX and TX pairs? Yes, absolutely, there are. USB corporate, the USB organization did unfortunately a bit a bad job in naming USB. So they renamed USB 3.0 several times. So in the newer specs, you can actually see it in the name. So now it's called USB 3.2 Gen. No, it's called, wow, it's called USB Gen 2 times 1 or USB 2 USB 3 Gen 2 times 2. So the times 2 in the end says that it uses more than one differential pair signal. So there is actually I have a table here which you can see it here, these naming conventions here. So this times 2 here in these two ways here indicate that it uses both lanes. So if you want to go up to 20 gigabit per seconds, you need to have two lanes, but you can do 10 gigabits either with two lanes and running each of them with 5 gigabits per second, or you can use one lane running them up to 10 gigabit per lane. So it is possible to use two lanes, yes. Okay, I really like the ST USB 4500, but it's not available today. Are there any good substitutes? Yes, in the current situation, it's really hard to find sources for these devices. There are other devices available, but not with the same feature set and not pin compatible, unfortunately. Because it's actually hard to find ones that are fully integrated without need of an external microcontroller, because that ST USB 4500 is actually pretty neat that it has its internal EEPROM, you can program it, and you don't need any interaction with a microcontroller or anything to get to use it. While a lot of chips, they actually need a microcontroller to do actually the whole thing. So yeah, I cannot really provide you an easy replacement here. Okay, then I think I have one more last question here. Goes actually in the same direction. What is the current stock of components for USB-C ICs? It's worth converting for a small Is it worth converting for a small quantity? Yeah, USB-C is actually in the current situation a bit of a pain because almost everything is sold out or hard to get. So yeah, as I said, the TUSB 3.2.1, it still has some siblings which are available, you can get. And I hope that soonish the rest of the components are getting, yeah, back on stock, but it's hard. So we can try to help you in our support channel to find something, but also for us, it's pretty hard to find components right now. They're still coming in some questions about 100 nano capacitors in series to the SSTX on your module. On your module, there is one implemented, but if you use a switch, yes, if you use a switch, then you have to be careful. It depends. First of all, it depends what kind of switch you're using. If you use an analog switch, you can, you don't really need them because it's a completely analog switch, but you can also place them. So I really highly recommend to follow our design guide in this regards. Okay, and then one more question. I think that will be the last one. I mean, an SST switch required for USB-C connector. Okay, I don't get the context, but I think I more or less know what you mean. So yes, for super speed, you really need the analog switch. Otherwise, you will have this meter-long stops with a full-featured cable. Okay, I actually the question and answer session was taking a bit longer than expected. I really thank you for listening in. It was I hope you were able to learn something. I was able to introduce you into the world of USB-C, as it is quite a complex world, but also quite an exciting world. And I think it would be great if you could consider implementing USB-C in your DeX design, as it is really the universal connector of the future, and we should use it. Thank you for your attention, and hopefully see you in another webinar. Have a good day. Thanks.